This is part one of a three-part video essay on progestogens and their role in hormonal contraception. In this first part, I'm going to cover progestogens. What is the difference between progesterone versus progestins, the classification systems for progestins, and steroid hormone receptor activity profiles? Let's start off with terminology. The three terms, progestogen, progesterone, and progestins, are easy to mix up. A progestogen is a compound whose main action is activation of the progesterone receptor. Note that most progestogens also interact with other steroid hormone receptors, which I will go into in a minute. The term progestin means synthetic progestogen. As for endogenous progestogens, the main one is essentially progesterone. So for the rest of this video, I'll just be using the terms progesterone and progestin. I've already gone over the different steroid hormones in a previous video, but to briefly recap, steroid hormones all have the signature cholesterol-derived four-ring backbone, and there are five types of steroid hormones: the mineralo and glucocorticoid steroids, and of the sex hormones, there are the progestogens, estrogens, and androgens. The pathway of synthesis is such that all the steroid hormones are synthesized into a progestogen first before converted to their final form. Each type of steroid hormone has their own receptor type. So there's the mineralocorticoid receptor for aldosterone, glucocorticoid receptor for cortisol, and so on. Perhaps not surprisingly, given the similarity of the steroid hormones, the steroid receptors are also quite similar to each other, and there is some crosstalking between steroid hormones and their different receptors. I'm only going to touch on crosstalking with regards to progesterone in order to keep this video brief. I drew this picture and it's more of an artist's impression. I've drawn a lot of receptors sitting on the surface of the cell, but actually steroid receptors are mostly floating around within the cell and also within the nucleus of the cell. The steroids actually diffuse into the cell to complex with their receptors, and then the complex migrates down to the DNA and binds to the respective gene to induce transcription. Now I'm going to start going into the steroid receptor profile of progesterone. So progesterone activates the progesterone receptor, but also has activity on the other steroid receptors too. Here's an example of steroid hormone crosstalk, whereby progesterone is also able to activate glucocorticoid receptors. It's not completely clear why it does this. It might have something to do with immune system modulation during pregnancy, but other than that, I'm not going to go much further into it, other than to say it's certainly interesting. Progesterone has an anti-estrogenic effect, and does so not by specifically blocking the estrogen receptor, but by downregulating estrogen receptors and reducing the numbers. Progesterone and estrogen, whilst working in concert together, also oppose a lot of each other's actions, which I'll come back to later. And progesterone blocks the androgen receptor and the mineralocorticoid receptors, so it has an anti-androgen and anti-mineralocorticoid effect, which I'll go more into later as well. As mentioned before, progesterone has an anti-GnRH effect. GnRH is the hypothalamic hormone of the sex hormones, and the anti-GnRH effect is not only exploited in hormonal contraception, but also in treating sex hormone-related conditions. For example, medroxyprogesterone is used for this. But otherwise, I'm going to be focusing more on the anti-mineralocorticoid and anti-androgenic effects, as these two come up the most with regard to the hormonal contraceptives.
So you can think of this steroid receptor activity profile of progesterone as a standard against which the other progestins can be compared to. As you can see, there are many different progestins, each one with their own activity profiles, which can vary quite a bit from that of progesterone. And not only that, the activity intensities can vary as well.
As there are many different progestins, I thought it would be helpful to reference commonly known oral contraceptive brand names whilst going over the different progestins. I'm just going to start off with these commonly seen ones in Hong Kong and then selectively add other brands as I go along.
I believe some of these brand names are internationally known. Those which aren't, such as Harmonette, I'll try and mention other international brand versions. Note, these particular brands are combined hormonal products which also include ethinyl estradiol. So these ones here all contain ethinyl estradiol and the names of the progestins have been bolded. There are two different categorization systems for progestins, one which is according to generations and the other one according to chemical structure. This is the one according to generations and is according to when they were synthesized. The first progestins are in the first generation, which include medroxyprogesterone and norethisterone, also known as norethindrone. Medroxyprogesterone has a lot of different uses. As a contraceptive, it is mostly seen as the depot injection Depo-Provera. And norethisterone is also used in oral contraception, but has mostly been superseded by levonorgestrel and the newer formulations. It is still often seen being used to stop bleeding and to restart menstrual cycles. The most well-known second-generation progestin is levonorgestrel, which is the progestin in microgynon 30, and the most commonly used progestin in contraceptive formulations. The third generation contains several different progestins, and the fourth generation contains drospirenone. Note, different references might have a slightly different placement for some of the progestins. And there are a couple of progestins which are typically not included in this system, for example, ciproterone, because traditionally ciproterone is considered to be an anti-androgen over a progestin. Whilst classification by generation is easier to understand, a categorization according to chemical structure is useful to know as it helps relate the progestin with their steroid receptor profile. In this slide across the top, there is progestin, testosterone, and spironolactone. And only progesterone is a progestin, and the other two are not progestins, but are the parent compounds from which the current progestins are derived from. So the first group are the progesterone derivatives, which includes medroxyprogesterone, and ciproterone acetate also belongs to this group. The next group are the testosterone derivatives. Testosterone is not a progestogen, but one of the first progestins discovered by accident was when scientists were trying to synthesize a synthetic androgen. And they found that this androgen that they synthesized was actually more progestogenic than androgenic, and this led to the synthesis of norethisterone. And then after that, later on came levonorgestrel. The next group are also testosterone derivatives, but more specifically are derived from levonorgestrel. So we have desogestrel and gestadine here. So these incidentally are the third generation progestins. And the last group are spironolactone derivatives, of which there is only drospirenone. And the name drospirenone is also derived from its parent compound spironolactone, which might be helpful in remembering its category. And this slide is to show the two classification systems side by side. So now let's go through the steroid receptor activity profiles of the different progestins. There's some conflicting data with regard to some of the receptor activities, but I think this is enough to give you an idea of how they can differ from progesterone. Starting with estrogenic activity, all the estrogens have anti-estrogenic activity. And interestingly, norethisterone also has some estrogenic activity. This is because it is partially converted into ethinyl estradiol in the body. Progesterone has glucocorticoid activity. So most of the progestins don't have glucocorticoid activity, with the notable exception of medroxyprogesterone acetate. And a couple of the third generation progestins have weak glucocorticoid activity. And the clinical significance of this is not really clear. Medroxyprogesterone acetate depot injections are associated with bone mineral density loss, so it could be speculated this glucocorticoid activity could be a contributing factor. For mineralocorticoid activity, none of the progestins have mineralocorticoid activity. Progesterone actually has anti-mineralocorticoid activity. In contrast, most of the progestins don't have anti-mineralocorticoid activity, with the notable exceptions of gestadine and drospirenone. Drospirenone was specifically derived from spironolactone, which is itself a potent anti-mineralocorticoid. this is of significance when it's given with an estrogen, because estrogens cause salt and water retention. This action is naturally opposed by the anti-mineralocorticoid action of progesterone. Progesterone does not have any androgenic activity and in addition is an androgen receptor blocker. A lot of the progestins are derived from testosterone, so almost all of these have androgenic activity, of which levonorgestrel is considered to be the most androgenic. Drospirenone is notable for being the only progestin with both anti-mineralocorticoid and anti-androgenic activity. Androgenic activity is associated with acne, hirsutism, and reducing HDL cholesterol. If given as a combined hormonal formulation, the estrogen component opposes these androgenic adverse effects for most people. However, there are some women who are more susceptible to these androgenic effects, for example, hirsutism. Cyproterone acetate is a potent anti-androgen, which when given with estrogen is reserved for women with clinical hyperandrogenism who also require contraception. Gestadine has androgenic activity, but as will be mentioned in the next section, also has high progestational activity, so can be given in low doses, which reduce its overall androgenic effect. And as for progestogenic activity, naturally all progestins have this, but some are actually more potent than others. Gestadine is the most progestogenic. This enables lower doses of it to be used in contraceptive formulations. And similarly with desogestrel, which I will talk about more in parts 2 and 3. So that is the end of this part 1. Stay tuned for part 2, where I go into progestins in hormonal contraception and the role of estrogen in combined hormonal contraceptives. Thank you for watching.